know, the second thing is that when you're speaking to somebody who is convincible, there are certain linguistic things you probably should not do. Don't talk about how Obama's not born in the United States. It's not true, and it's a waste of time. Don't talk about how he's a socialist. It is true, but it's a waste of time. Don't talk about how he has, you know, un-American views on foreign policy, which, again, is true, but is a waste of time. When I say un-American, what I say is not traditionally American. He doesn't believe in a muscular American foreign policy. The key here when you're talking to, you know, your liberal friends is to kind of use Alinsky tactics. I'm a big fan of Saul Alinsky. If you haven't read Rules for Radicals, you absolutely should. It's a brilliant book. Saul Alinsky was a brilliant man. Despite the demonization of Saul Alinsky, his book is well worth reading. What he says in his book, essentially, is that the way to convince people is to freeze a target, pick a target, freeze it, and then polarize it. That's true of issues, too. When you sit down with your liberal friends, first thing you should do is you should ask them why they're voting for Obama, or how they're voting and then why they're voting that way. Don't lead off the conversation with, here's why you shouldn't vote for Obama, because it will immediately alienate them. Then when they start throwing issues at you, you can knock them down one by one. The good news is that President Obama is the worst president in the history of the United States, with the exception of James Buchanan. So it gives you a lot of material to work with. That's the good news. The bad news is that a lot of people have been dramatically misinformed by the media about the nature of President Obama's record on everything from economics to foreign policy to social policy. So the way that I sort of decided to structure this tonight was I wanted to go down kind of some of the key points I think that come up that in discussions that I've had with some of my liberal friends, and shamefully I do have liberal friends. One of them you hear with me on the Heidi Harris show. Brian Levin's a liberal, and Brian's a sweetheart, but he's wrong. So I have a list of issues, and I think they're worth discussing and how to tackle each one of them. The first one that you get a lot from folks, especially liberals, is Obama made the decision to kill Osama bin Laden. Now, there are two ways to handle this question. There's the right way and there's the wrong way. The right way is factually correct, but tactically incorrect. The factually correct answer is that President Obama did make a good call after waffling around for 3 days and after voting against everything that would have allowed us to gain the intelligence that led to the kill of bin Laden. That's factually correct. And when he issued the memo that called for the kill of bin Laden, which was written by Leon Panetta, it was basically a throw somebody under the bus memo. It was, if something goes wrong, we're going to blame this on Admiral McMullen. That's essentially what the memo says. I mean, I have the text of it right here. Essentially, it says, the approval is provided on the risk profile presented to the president. Any additional risks are to be brought back to the president for his consideration. The direction is to go in and get bin Laden. Now, there are a couple problems with that. This is just, you know, kind of bad for background information. First problem with that is that it's a fluid situation. If you went back to President Obama every time there was a differentiation in the risk profile, the mission never gets done. So if any additional risk happens, if the helicopter goes down, for example, as it does, and they call up Obama, they say, should we proceed? You know, he has the option to say no. If they go ahead and they kill bin Laden, great, he gets the credit. If not, if he, you know, the phone suddenly cuts out, and then he can always find somebody to blame. The other problem with that is that he says to go in and get bin Laden. This is the language that led to the unclarity in the aftermath of the bin Laden kill. You heard a lot of people saying, well, was it a kill order or was it a capture order? The answer is it was neither. It was a get bin Laden order. And so that gave him the freedom to kind of claim one way or another. The White House couldn't even decide on its messaging. That's the factual answer. It's also the wrong answer to give to liberals. The reason is because everybody in the United States is firmly convinced that Obama made the heroic call to kill bin Laden and did it with ease and with confidence.
Absolutely.
That being the case, the proper answer to the he killed bin Laden is, you're right, he did, now let's look at the rest of his record. Because guess what? You kill one dude, it doesn't really change the world all that much, even bin Laden. And it was a wonderful thing when bin Laden ended up, you know, smoldering with gun holes in him. That was wonderful. When he was bleeding out, you know, the world was celebrating, it was great. But guess what? Al-Qaeda still existed. We are still cutting and running in Afghanistan because we do not have a comprehensive plan there. We already cut and run in Iraq and it's being turned over to Iran. The entire Middle East is being converted to an Islamist awakening. The Europeans are taking precedence over us in terms of largely negotiations with Syria. We've thrown our allies under the bus, Israel in particular, and I'll get to more on that later. So the issue is we have to keep the focus. This is the real issue of this campaign, and you've seen it with Paul Ryan. To digress for just a second, you've seen it with Paul Ryan. Ryan focused the campaign. For about 10 days there, we were actually talking about stuff that mattered. We were talking about Medicare. We were talking about the economy. We were talking about the nature of what the next 50 years in this country is going to look like. And then Todd Akin said something about magic uteruses. And we were back to talking about nonsense. And we've been talking about nonsense for the last 48, 72 hours because he said that women's uteruses have magical capacity to determine the difference between rape and consensual sex.
Yeah, right.
This is not exactly what we should be talking about at this point in time. So when people say things, you know, they'll do the same thing about Todd Akin, which I'll get to a little bit later too. When they say this, you say, you know what, you're right, now let's get back to the issues that matter. Because guess what? Todd Akin's a dude from Missouri, and our country is still going to pay the entire military budget of the country of China just with the interest on our debt by 2020.
Wow.
Okay. So that's the answer on Bin Laden. Second one is, hasn't Obama created jobs? This one should be a no-brainer, but it's good for you to have the data at your fingertips. The annual growth rate under President Obama has been 2% since the recovery began. That is the weakest single recovery in the history of the United States since World War II. He has created less jobs than any president of the United States since World War II, according to the Washington Post. Okay, the Obama Washington Post. President Obama has done a horrible job on the economy. We'll talk about his tax policy and his spending policy in just a moment. But the fact of the matter is that when they talk about number of months that he's had, you know, consistent job creation, it's easy enough to do that when you inflate the currency and spend enormous sums of cash. You can do that. You just can't do it indefinitely, and the recovery will not end up being particularly strong. George W. Bush, you might want to remind your liberal friends, had a, I think it was a period that was twice as long as President Obama's has been in terms of consistent months of job growth. And he was gaining more jobs per month on average than President Obama does, the hated and reviled President George W. Bush. So, as for him creating jobs, the answer is no. And that's why when Joe Biden goes out there and says that they've created 200,000 good-paying new jobs, the answer to that is, okay, if that's all the jobs that you've created in a country of 335 million people, you got a problem. 200,000 jobs is not a lot of jobs. And that's the issue. One more point to be made there. The unemployment rate, which, you know, has hovered around 8.3%, is due to jump back to 9% in January, according to the CBO today. Things are about to get a lot worse. And they're about to get a lot worse because of President Obama. And in fact, when President Obama had full control, the recovery has largely been under, guess what, a Republican Congress. When it was a Democrat Congress, there was pretty much no recovery. In the last couple years, when there was some recovery, if there was any recovery at all, that's because the government couldn't do anything. It was shut. Right? The Republicans and Obama were fighting and nothing was getting done. I mean, it was great. It was just like when Clinton was fighting with the Republican Congress and nobody could bother us. If they would all go out on vacation, we could actually live our lives and make money. Okay, the next issue you get a lot, and these are all straight, by the way, from the Obama talking points. You go on his website and you'll see, they're all there. When he made that movie with Davis Guggenheim, that horrible 15-minute monstrosity, narrated by Tom Hanks, you know, complete with swelling music and nonsensical voiceovers from Joe Biden, when he did that, all these points are addressed by President Obama in there. So this is we're taking kind of the most glowing picture of President Obama, and we're going to talk about how you deal with that. The car bailout. Okay, he keeps talking about the car bailout, how he saved Detroit. Well, you can save any business as long as you tax people three times as much money to make that happen. The American public is still $35 billion in debt on the GM bailout. GM has not recovered. GM is a disaster area. All you have to do is look at its stock price. When GM IPO'd in 2010, it IPO'd at an initial stock price of $33 a share. It is now trading at $20 a share. The American public has taken the shaft on GM. And guess what constitutes a vast quantity of cars sold by GM? Government contracts. There's a reason they're replacing all of their executives in Europe and many of their executives in the United States, and the answer is the government is not good at running things, including car companies. And when it comes to Chrysler, the people who were shafted, because someone always has to take the shaft when you decide to bail someone out, the folks who were shafted in the Chrysler bailout were the actual bondholders, as well as people who had, for example, personal liability suits against Chrysler. There were people who had been involved in product liability suits, been killed in Chrysler cars. All of the debt that Chrysler owed to them was wiped out, while the UAW and the rest of the auto unions got a giant payoff, which is what they wanted. When they negotiated down the debt for GM, the bondholders ended up with 29 cents on the dollar, and the UAW ended up with well over 50 cents on the dollar. Even though UAW was secondary to bondholders in typical bankruptcy order. The auto bailout has been a complete and utter disaster, and yet President Obama recently said he wants to do with the entire industry of the United States what he did with GM. It's put that in perspective, the market capitalization of Xi'an at current fiscal point is $32 billion. The American public owes $35 billion on Xi'an. So if we wanted to do that with the United States, all we would have to do is borrow more money than the entire U.S. economy is worth, multiply that by 30%, and then spend it to pay off all of those businesses if they're running as badly as GM was. Yeah, fourth issue. How about Obama being respected around the world? Do you remember when President Obama, he came out and he was going to go across the seas and the waters were going to recede and people were going to cheer in the streets. I mean, it was going to be like the end of World War II. They're going to throw candies at him and it was just going to be phenomenal. And he had his cheering throngs and everything was great. And then it was the day after the election and this boob was president. And now he had to run America's foreign policy. And guess what? It didn't work out particularly well, especially for America's allies. I'm going to start with Israel because Israel is near and dear to my heart. I'm an Orthodox Jew. My wife is Israeli. And we were married in Israel. A lot of her family still lives in Israel. My sister recently lived in Israel. Israel has been absolutely devastated by the Obama presidency. What he has done with Iran is absolutely inexcusable. What he has done with Egypt is inexcusable. What he has done with Syria is inexcusable. It is borderline anti-Semitic the way he has treated Israel. And the only reason I say borderline on that is because, you know, he hasn't actually said anything overtly anti-Semitic. His policies have been so deeply anti-Israel and so discriminatory against Israel that it's beyond belief. And a good example of this, when he was telling Israel to freeze settlements, right, this was one of his first things, Israel has to freeze settlements. The very same time, because Israel had, of course, to trade land for peace with the Palestinians, which we have another name for that in the real world, it's called blackmail. When you trade things for peace, that's called blackmail. At the same time that Obama was doing that with Israel, he was saying about Pakistan, which was then in conflict and still is with the Taliban, he was saying it would be unwise for the Pakistanis to turn over territory to the Taliban in return for peace. It's different when it's Jews than when it's Muslims. President Obama, there are two really great examples of President Obama and Israel that are just inexcusable. First one is there's a counterterrorism conference, a world counterterrorism conference. And if there's a world counterterrorism conference, Israel's great at a lot of things. Okay, if there's one thing that Israel is probably the best at, it is counterterrorism, right? Israel's not even invited by the Obama State Department because Obama doesn't want to offend the Arab nations. But guess who is invited? Places like Turkey are invited, right? Turkey, the source of the flotilla, the terrorist flotilla heading toward Israel, right toward Hamas, they're invited. Israel, not invited. Another indicator. And by the way, Dianne Feinstein says this, right? Other Democrats say this. The Obama administration has repeatedly been leaking key vital national security information about Israel to the world via the New York Times and the Washington Post. They've done it no less than three times. They've done it in order to try and stop Israel from attacking Iran. The first time, they leaked information from the Defense Department that Israel was going to use Saudi airspace in order to hit the Iranian nuclear facilities. That came out, Saudis immediately pulled that off the table. The second time, they leaked that Israel had been involved in the Stuxnet virus. Right, that was the really, really cool virus they used to shut down the Iranian nuclear facilities for a while. It's a super cool thing. And they leaked that it was Israel that had done that, right, undercutting Israeli security. The third way, recently, they did this, the worst of all, was that Israel had a deal with Azerbaijan to use its air bases in order as a staging point for an attack against Iran. The Obama administration leaked that to the press, killing the deal. The Obama administration is still, just the other day, on the press plane, the Obama press secretary, Jay Carney, who is a Rachel Maddow lookalike, in his day job. Jay Carney. Jay Carney was aboard Air Force One.
Poor Jay.
Yeah, really. Poor Rachel. Jay was aboard Air Force One. He was giving his press gaggle to the sycophantic press, and they asked him about Iran, and he said, "We still think there are many diplomatic options available, despite the fact that nothing has happened." In fact, he said, "We're pushing Israel to exercise those diplomatic options." This is who President Obama is. This is also the president, of course, who has facilitated the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, who is facilitating the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood in Libya, who has facilitated the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood in Tunisia. His foreign policy record isn't just bad, it's abysmal. What he's done with Russia has been abysmal. The bear is on the move again. Vladimir Putin is emboldened, and he's making territorial moves in Ukraine. If you look at China has been massively emboldened. They are actually making military moves in the South China Sea against the Philippines, if you've been following that. This is what Joe Biden predicted back in 2008 when he was running against President Obama for the nomination. He said, when you have a president who's brand new and has no experience and who looks kind of weak, People are going to start pushing the envelope. That's what's happened. Obama has not pushed back. America is not safer for it. America is less safe in the world. There's virtually no argument on that. Okay, next issue, same-sex marriage. This one, obviously, this is Obama's key. It's amazing to me that this is true, but this has become the centerpiece of his campaign. It's not a real good strategy, considering the swing states in this country are Virginia, Ohio, Florida, Pennsylvania, and a vast panoply of Rust Belt states that don't like same-sex marriage. I mean, the fact is that he's going to get a lot of negative heat when he's in North Carolina because of the same-sex marriage position. Now, we're in California. Same-sex marriage, obviously, a very popular proposition. A lot of us work in Hollywood. And that is, for my money, and when I wrote my book, I talked to a lot of the big executives, at the studios. And essentially, it is almost the work-don't-work line. If you voted for Prop 8 or contributed money to the Prop 8 effort, there's a solid, and they find out about it, there's a solid chance you'll be discriminated against or that you won't work altogether. So, that being the case, let's not take this one from the position of traditional marriage is superior to same-sex marriage, even though I personally believe that because I'm a religious person, and also I think there are solid secular reasons to believe that. It's not a winning argument in the state of California in particular. So the real answer is, okay, President Obama is for same-sex marriage, what has changed? And the answer is, nothing has changed. Precisely the same number of people who could get married before can still get married, and precisely the same number of people who can't. And President Obama has done nothing to change that. It's an attitude, I mean, it sounds great, but it's been largely irrelevant. And in the end, it will probably end up being a states' rights issue. It's going to go to the Supreme Court will probably declare that it's a states' rights issue. They're not going to declare, I should revise that. It may be a moot point pretty soon, because Anthony Kennedy is the swing vote on the Supreme Court. He voted in favor of Lawrence v. Texas, right, which said that sodomy was a right in the Constitution. So Anthony Kennedy's a kook, and he could vote that the founders in 1791, when they ratified the Constitution of the United States, actually wanted two men to get married. But, it could remove the topic from the table. But leaving that aside, the policy is not actually going to change. And the difference between Romney on this policy and Obama on this policy makes no practical difference. And again, not the central issue. And that's the point that's worth emphasizing again. This is not the central issue of this election. It really is not. We could have nominated Rick Santorum, and then it would have been the central issue of this election. We nominated Mitt Romney specifically so that this would not be the central issue of this election. Okay, which brings us to the vastly talked about this week abortion issue. Right? This is something that the left loves to talk about because it's just, it's a key issue for them. And it's the only way they can keep people in the fold is by scaring the hell out of single women in particular. Married women tend to poll extremely high in favor of pro-life decisions. Single women tend to poll very high in favor of pro-choice decisions. The left has therefore tried to polarize this debate and essentially say that the Republican Party wants you to use coat hangers. Now, I'm not just saying that. That was the headline on Huffington Post yesterday. I don't know if you saw this. There was actually a large graphic of a coat hanger. Joan Crawford would have been thrilled. It was...
Hollywood show.
Oh, mommy dearest. Anyway. Okay. Here's the story on abortion. Once again, when it comes to abortion, this is not an issue that's going to play a large role in this campaign or in American policy going forward. Even if Roe v. Wade were overturned, there will be no difference for people who live in California. Right? And presumably you're speaking mostly to your friends who live in California. If your friends are living in Alabama and they're really that concerned about abortion, tell them to move. It's called federalism. There's a reason for it. Right? If people want to abort their children, abort their fetuses, whatever you want to call it, their embryos, they can do that in California, they can do that in New York, they'll be able to do it in Massachusetts, they may not be able to do that in Texas, but guess what? We can agree to disagree. That's why we have a federalist society. And you can tell them this, too. The Republicans are never going to get enough of a majority to pass a pro-life amendment. It's just not going to happen. It never will happen. There will never be a pro-life constitutional amendment in this country. So that should obviate the abortion issue. When they mentioned Todd Akin, there's a reason that Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan both called Todd Akin and told him to get out. And he should have gotten out. And the fact that he didn't, it's a disgrace, and he's an egotist of beyond measure, because Obamacare could end up becoming law. We'll talk about Obamacare in just a second. Obamacare could end up being enshrined in law because Todd Akin's a moron. Yeah. The other one that they like to push is the Lilly Ledbetter Act, right? This one they push a lot. And this is big in California, the wage gap, right? The so-called wage gap between men and women. The easy answer to this one is, there's a factual answer again, and then there's the politic answer. The factual answer is that there is no wage gap in this country. For people who work the same amount of time, have the same amount of years at the job, and work the same number of hours, there is not only not a wage gap, there's a slight wage advantage for women. There are more women who are now going to medical school than men. There are more women in law school than men. The idea that women are somehow radically disadvantaged in American society is sheer crap. It is, and I, honestly, my wife is at UCLA Medical School, my mom is a working woman, she runs a studio. This is working, I'm all for working women. But let me just say this, if we could actually pay women 70 cents, 77 cents on the dollar to work, and we'd have to pay men 100 cents on the dollar to work, I guarantee you no men would be employed. Okay, now that's the non-politic answer. Okay, the politic answer is that the Lilly Ledbetter Act is not the way to solve the wage and gender imbalance. Because what the Lilly Ledbetter Act does is it extends the period for which people can sue. The only people who work under, the only thing that happens under the Lilly Ledbetter Act, which was Obama's first act in office, because this whole, you know, war on women meme that he's been pushing this for years. And it's a bunch of nonsense, and he's been pushing it because he knows that it works. The Lilly Ledbetter Act makes trial lawyers rich, doesn't help anybody else. Because what it does, it puts the burden on businesses. If you show up and you just show that you made less money than a man, now the burden shifts to the business to somehow explain why they're not sexist, which is fundamentally un-American. Burden of proof should be on the person who's making the charge. Right? So that's the real problem with the Lilly Ledbetter Act, leaving aside the basis of it, which again, is specious. Okay, how about energy? President Obama likes to say that he's increased drilling in the country. He has not increased drilling in the country. Drilling has increased on private land. It has decreased on public land. The actual statistic, and there's a reason, by the way, that gasoline prices this week were up to $3.72 on average. That's a 26-cent leap in the last month, and it's up over $2 from when President Bush was president. You know, the horrible, evil, terrible President Bush. Oil production overall is higher than it has been in 8 years. That's because 96% of the increase came from land not owned by the federal government. In 2011, oil production on federal lands declined by an average of 275,000 barrels per day. It increased on private land more than that by about 400,000 barrels a day. So private land is where it's at, public land is where it's not at, and there's a reason for that, which is that President Obama has a goal, and he expressed it very clearly before the election. He wants to raise oil prices so that we can reduce pollution and we use less oil. He wants to make us energy independent. He'll have to bankrupt the country to do it, but at least, you know, you'll be driving a lighter car or you'll have a Segway. So that's the upside. The downside is that, you know, the few of us who are still making money will have to pay for those Segways. Okay, so how about taxes? President Obama has claimed that he has not raised taxes. This is true. He has not raised taxes. It's not for lack of trying. President Obama will, if you count Obamacare as a tax, it's the single biggest tax increase in American history. I don't count Obamacare as a tax because it's a mandate, no matter what John Roberts and his foolish compatriots on the Supreme Court say. It's not a tax, it's a mandate. But if we're going to claim that it's a tax, it is the single largest tax increase in the history of the United States. We can talk a little bit more about Obamacare in just a second. The fact is that President Obama has said that he wants the Bush tax cuts to expire not for a reason of economic health, but for reasons of fairness. He said this in the debate back in 2008. He said, he was asked specifically, if you know that tax increases are going to hurt the economy, are you still for them? And he said, yes, for purposes of fairness. Direct quote. That's all he cares about. All he cares about is fairness. He doesn't care about the growth of the United States economy, and he certainly doesn't care about lowering anybody's taxes. So this poses a middle class, you know, lower class warrior. When he says he's cutting taxes for, you know, people who are low income, no, he's not, because they don't pay taxes. He's giving them money from your pocket and calling it a tax rebate. You know, by that standard, every time I get a check from my company, I'm getting a tax rebate. Because, you know, hell, money that comes from anywhere is a tax rebate now, apparently. It's insipid, it doesn't make any sense. President Obama is going to raise taxes come 2013. And this just came out from the CBO today. If he does raise those taxes, the unemployment rate is going to rise to 9% immediately. And by the way, it'll rise to higher than that, because it turns out the CBO, this is the problem with the CBO, and you should, good informational point, point of order, you know, for you when you check out the CBO. The CBO only calculates data that they're given. It's garbage in, garbage out. If they're giving bad data, this has happened with what happened with Obamacare. If they're giving bad data by the administration, that's what they calculate. The data that they were given by the administration, calculating what would happen if the taxes would rise, assumed, get this, that there would be a surge in tax revenue in 2013 to 18.4% from 15.7% of GDP. So there would be almost a 3% increase in tax revenue even though the economy would tank. So unemployment would go up to 9%, but somehow we'd make more money in taxes.
No.
Not going to happen. That's not what happens when you raise taxes. There may be a short-term there may be a short-term revenue increase, and then it immediately sinks. So the economy will be even worse than that because the government won't be able to pay for any of this, which of course increases the debt. Which brings us to the debt. When people say that there was this meme going around a few months ago. Now, liberals don't like to argue. This is the substantive stuff that liberals don't like to argue. So this is why I say, don't bother arguing with liberals. You can tell a liberal from the first 5 minutes of conversation if they don't want to stick on one topic. This is the hallmark. If they start sliding around, right, you start talking about the budget, and all of a sudden you find yourself talking about gay marriage. You realize, oh, wait a second, something happened here. Honestly, if you are talking about tax increases, and all of a sudden they're talking about the Lilly Ledbetter Act and why Romney hates women because he's a Mormon put a dog on top of his car, you're in the wrong conversation. Get out immediately. Don't leave. You know, if there's somebody else there, leave him behind. Run, man. There's no time. Get out. So here's the story on the deficit. There is a meme going around about President Obama, the deficit, that he is actually a fiscal conservative. I don't know if you saw this one. Right? The fact that it gets such a big laugh when I just say that means that you're not going to get liberals arguing that too much. But there was this meme going around for a while that President Obama, and it was a manipulation of the math, that President Obama had actually not increased government spending that much. That's true to a certain extent. It's true if you consider the last Bush year, the last Bush budget that was submitted, and then was greenlit by Obama's Democratic Congress. If you consider that the baseline, then yeah, Obama hasn't increased spending that much. But that's like saying you smash up your car in a wreck, it sets on fire, and you buy yourself a new car. And then every year, till the end of time, you buy a new car, you haven't increased your spending that much, because that first year, you bought a car. Okay, when the economy went bad and we spent a lot of money, that doesn't mean you get to spend that much money every single year. You're supposed to bring it back down, right? During World War II, after World War II happened, guess what? We decreased spending. You know why? Because we weren't in a war, right? I mean, this is what happens. Spending goes up, spending goes down, unless you're President Obama, in which case the ratchet only works one way. So here's Obama's spending record, okay? Stimulus package, $1 trillion. Supplemental spending bill, $410 billion. Ship expansion, $40 billion. Obamacare, $1.6 trillion over the next 10 years. It will be more than that. He's now spending a full quarter of America's GDP versus an average of 19.6% under President Bush. That's an increase of almost 6% of the American GDP being spent by the government. The last year, in 2008, our annual budget was about a little under $3 trillion. It's now, it's going to be this year about $3.8 trillion. And there's President Obama's so extreme, when he calls Paul Ryan an extremist, it's actually laughable. Paul Ryan got a majority of the House to vote for him and 40 votes in the Senate. President Obama got this many votes in the House and the Senate for his last two budgets. This many. Zero. Not a single Democrat voted for it because they knew how asinine it was. And they knew that they would have to go back to their constituents and explain why their constituents were paying for toilet paper for unemployed minors in Pennsylvania. There's four straight years of budget deficits came out today at over $1 trillion. So that's a non-starter. As far as benefits, President Obama's entire plan, and this goes to the key of who President Obama is. Again, not something for arguing, but a good informational point. Want to know where Obama's going? The answer is, he's creating a society in which more of us are dependent on government than are not dependent on government, so Democrats will win every election until the end of time. There are 100 million people who are currently dependent on federal benefits. 100 million people. And in terms of state benefits, probably higher than that. We've got, I think there are 43 million people on food stamps.
Yes.
Under President Obama?
49.
40, is it 49 now? Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it'll keep increasing. The fact is that President Obama wants nothing more than to put people on these benefits in the name of kindness and humanity. Now, there's two ways to read that from President Obama. One is that he's a kind and generous human being with your money. And two is that this is part of a cohesive democratic plan that has been taking root since the 1930s to make more and more people dependent on the federal government so that you will need to keep electing these politicians. The problem I have is that the Republican Party for too long went along with this nonsense. And there's a reason for that too, which is, guess what? How many of us would actually be giving lots of money to either party if the government were insignificant in our lives, as Rick Perry wanted to make it? We wouldn't. They'd be a bunch of schlubs who go up to Washington and don't bother us for a couple of years and, you know, aren't around to soil our doorsteps and, you know, everything would be great. When people say that President Obama golfs too much, my answer is, I wish you were golfing every day so you couldn't do anything. I let all these guys go out and play basketball. I want Obama, you know, throwing like a girl at the All-Star game every day of the week. Yeah, exactly. Good. Keep them there. So the fact is that if we want government to become, and this is where we really come in as the voters, if we want government to be insignificant in our lives, the only way that's going to happen is if we say that the politicians that we elect don't get to make the call. And this is one of the things that I like about Mitt Romney, to digress for one second. I was not a Mitt Romney proponent in the primaries. I was initially a Rick Perry proponent before we discovered that he has problems with the English language. Once we realized that, then Romney became the only viable choice, just because everybody else, it was like the Wheel of Fortune primary. Literally, Rick Santorum was the last man standing on the right side of the stage in the first primary. I said this, and we were going to go through every single person until we got to Rick Santorum, because Romney was everybody's second or third choice, and we ended up with Mitt Romney. That's fine. It's totally fine. But, you know, he's not exactly an inspiring candidate, which is why he needed Paul Ryan. That being the case, there's one good thing about Mitt Romney. There's one really good thing about Mitt Romney. It's not that he's a deeply principled guy, because I don't think he is. It's not because he is a strong Reagan-esque conservative, because I'm not sure that he is. I don't know. I don't think anybody really knows. I think Romney maybe, I know Ryan is. But I have my questions about Romney, but here's the nice thing. Romney is susceptible to public pressure. I like that. It means that if we pressure him and we push him the right way, he will do what we want him to do. I don't like hero worship of presidents. There was too much of it with George W. Bush, and it allowed him to spend egregious amounts of money doing silly things. If we don't worship our politicians, we're better off. I think the last 4 years have proved that. So, you know, that's the good news about Mitt Romney. Okay, final point. Final point here about Obama. His big legislative accomplishment, thanks to John Roberts. I can't even discuss John Roberts. I'm a Harvard law grad, and John Roberts is a disgrace to my alma mater. He is. It was the worst decision. I thought it was the single worst legal decision, certainly since Roe. Maybe even worse than Roe. It was an egregiously bad legal decision. But now that it's the law of the land, at least for the moment, until we win the presidency and Senate, Obamacare. We've been told that Obamacare is the cure-all for everything. Your liberal friends will think that it is. When you ask them why we need Obamacare, they'll tell you that it's because there are 30 million uninsured people in this country, and they need insurance. There's only one problem. In 2012, the CBO estimated how many people would be left uninsured under Obamacare because they would lose, you know, their private insurance, because they'd lose their jobs, for whatever reason. The answer?
30 million
people. Precisely the same number of people who we were supposed to solve this problem for. And in California, what you hear a lot is, well, you know, you see all these illegal immigrants who are in the emergency rooms, and Obamacare will solve it. No, it won't. No, it won't. President Obama himself said, right, remember Joe Wilson, you lie? That's what that was about. Right, he said, it applies to illegal immigrants. Obama said it doesn't. Let's take Obama at his word. If Obamacare does not apply to illegal immigrants, all those illegal immigrants will still go to the emergency room, and they will still demand service, and they will still get it, and you will still pay for it. It doesn't solve any of the problems, and it creates massive new headaches. My wife's in medical school. We actively thought about pulling her out of medical school when Obamacare passed. Because the fact is, she will not be paid enough. We are going to invest, I'm sure there are doctors in the room, but as the husband of somebody going through medical school, I think people need to appreciate what doctors go through to get to be doctors. She's going to be in school for the next 8 years minimum. We're going to be shelling out a minimum of $40,000 to $50,000 a year, pretty much that entire time. Where we put off having children so that she can do that. Right, our lives have changed radically, so she can serve the public, and yes, so she can make money. Because guess what, this is a capitalist society, and we don't rip on people who do good things for money. Obamacare destroys the relationship between the patient and the doctor, because the best doctors are going to do one thing and one thing only. That's right. They can do two things. They can quit. If they've already been in a long time enough, they'll quit. And a lot of folks have talked about that. Up to 80% of doctors have said they would be interested in quitting if this happens. The other answer is, of course, what doctors should do, which is they take only cash.
Right.
And at that point, we're all in serious trouble, because guess what? Then costs really are high, because we have to shell out of pocket in order to make that happen. Now, the good news is, if enough doctors go to a cash-only system, guess what? Now we have a free market again, and they're all competing with each other. So, you know, Obamacare may end up being the best solution ever to all this. But in the short term, it's going to hurt a lot of people. The people it's first going to hurt are the people who are on Medicare, which is going to be slashed under Obama's plan. And the people who are going to be the most hurt are the elderly. The elderly are going to be hurt because there are not enough doctors to go around, there are not enough resources to go around. Everyone is going to be rationed at a certain point because every government program is rationed. There's not a single government program on earth that is not rationed in some form or fashion. Obamacare is not effective. If it were effective, we'd be for it. It isn't effective. It's a violation of personal freedom, and it is a violation of the relationship between human beings and their doctors. Those are really that was 12 points, believe it or not. Those 12 points are the ones that your liberal friends are probably going to bring up. That's how you should discuss them. Don't get passionate. I can get passionate here because we're among friends. Don't get passionate. Keep it calm. Keep it reasoned. It's very difficult for people to argue with facts, especially when you have your data points lined up. You know, don't hit them. You don't have to hit them with a paragraph, but you can have a nice discussion with liberals. There's certain people, look, I'm not going to convince my grandmother. She still thinks FDR is a lie. No matter what I do, I can tell her repeatedly that FDR is dead and that President Obama is radically anti-Israel, and she will not care. She will still vote Democrat. And so I have a simple solution for her. I tell her not to vote. So that's the other solution. So you have two missions leaving tonight. The first is to find your friends who are not going to, you know, shift the argument around. They're not active politicos, you know, people who are not going to, who actually want to seek truth instead of defending President Obama. That's mission number one, and try and convince them. Mission number two is to find as many liberals as you possibly can and tell them it's a foregone conclusion that Obama's going to win, so they should just stay home. Particularly strong. George W. Bush, you might want to remind your liberal friends, I think it was a period that was twice as long as President Obama's has been in terms of consistent months of job growth. And he was gaining more jobs per month on average than President Obama does, the hated and reviled President George W. Bush. So, as for him creating jobs, the answer is no. And that's why when Joe Biden goes out there and says that they've created 200,000 good-paying new jobs, the answer to that is, okay, if that's all the jobs that you've created in a country of 335 million people, you got a problem. 200,000 jobs is not a lot of jobs. And that's the issue. One more point to be made there. The unemployment rate, which, you know, has hovered around 8.3%, is due to jump back to 9% in January, according to the CBO today. Things are about to get a lot worse. And they're about to get a lot worse because of President Obama. And in fact, when President Obama had full control, the recovery has largely been under, guess what, a Republican Congress. When it was a Democrat Congress, there was pretty much no recovery. In the last couple years, when there was some recovery, if there was any recovery at all, that's because the government couldn't do anything. It was shut. Right? The Republicans and Obama were fighting and nothing was getting done. I mean, it was great. It was just like when Clinton was fighting with the Republican Congress and nobody could bother us. If they would all go out on vacation, we could actually live our lives and make money. Okay, the next issue you get a lot, and these are all straight, by the way, from the Obama talking points. You go on his website and you'll see, they're all there. When he made that movie with Davis Guggenheim, that horrible 15-minute monstrosity narrated by Tom Hanks, you know, complete with swelling music and nonsensical voiceovers from Joe Biden, when he did that, all these points are addressed by President Obama in there. So this is we're taking kind of the most glowing picture of President Obama, and we're going to talk about how you deal with that. The car bailout. Okay, he keeps talking about the car bailout, how he saved Detroit. Well, you can save any business as long as you tax people three times as much money to make that happen. The American public is still $35 billion in debt on the GM bailout. GM has not recovered. GM is a disaster area. All you have to do is look at its stock price. When GM IPO'd in 2010, it IPO'd at an initial stock price of $33 a share. It is now trading at $20 a share. The American public has taken the shaft on GM. And guess what constitutes a vast quantity of cars sold by GM? Government contracts. There's a reason they're replacing all of their executives in Europe and many of their executives in the United States, and the answer is the government is not good at running things, including car companies. And when it comes to Chrysler, the people who were shafted, because someone always has to take the shaft when you decide to bail someone out, the folks who were shafted in the Chrysler bailout were the actual bondholders, as well as people who had, for example, personal liability suits against Chrysler. There were people who had been involved in product liability suits, been killed in Chrysler cars. All of the debt that Chrysler owed to them was wiped out, while the UAW and the rest of the auto unions got a giant payoff, which is what they wanted. When they negotiated down the debt for GM, the bondholders ended up with 29 cents on the dollar, and the UAW ended up with well over 50 cents on the dollar. Even though UAW was secondary to bondholders in typical bankruptcy order. The auto bailout has been a complete and utter disaster, and yet President Obama recently said he wants to do with the entire industry of the United States what he did with GM. to put that in perspective, the market capitalization of GM at current physical point is $32 billion. The American public owes $35 billion on GM. So if we wanted to do that with the United States, all we would have to do is borrow more money than the entire U.S. economy is worth, multiply that by 30%, and then spend it to pay off all of those businesses if they're running as badly as GM was. Yeah, fourth issue. How about Obama being respected around the world? Do you remember when President Obama, he came out and he was going to go across the seas and the waters were going to recede and people were going to cheer in the streets. I mean, it was going to be like the end of World War II. They're going to throw candies at him and it was just going to be phenomenal. And he had his cheering throngs and everything was great. And then it was the day after the election and this boob was president. And now he had to run America's foreign policy. And guess what? It didn't work out particularly well, especially for America's allies. I'm going to start with Israel because Israel is near and dear to my heart. I'm an Orthodox Jew. My wife is Israeli. And we were married in Israel. A lot of her family still lives in Israel. My sister recently lived in Israel. Israel has been absolutely devastated by the Obama presidency. What he has done with Iran is absolutely inexcusable. What he has done with Egypt is inexcusable. What he has done with Syria is inexcusable. It is borderline anti-Semitic the way he has treated Israel. And the only reason I say borderline on that is because, you know, he hasn't actually said anything overtly anti-Semitic, but his policies have been so deeply anti-Israel and so discriminatory against Israel that it's beyond belief. And a good example of this, when he was telling Israel to freeze settlements, right, this is one of his first things, Israel has to freeze settlements, the very same time, because Israel had, of course, to trade land for peace with the Palestinians, which we have another name for that in the real world, it's called blackmail. When you trade things for peace, that's called blackmail. At the same time that Obama was doing that with Israel, he was saying about Pakistan, which was then in conflict and still is with the Taliban, he was saying it would be unwise for the Pakistanis to turn over territory to the Taliban in return for peace. It's different when it's Jews than when it's Muslims. President Obama, there are two really great examples of President Obama and Israel that are just inexcusable. First one is there's a counterterrorism conference, a world counterterrorism conference, and if there's a world counterterrorism conference, Israel's great at a lot of things. Okay, if there's one thing that Israel is probably the best at, it is counterterrorism, right? Israel's not even invited by the Obama State Department because Obama doesn't want to offend the Arab nations. But guess who is invited? Places like Turkey are invited, right? Turkey, the source of the flotilla, the terrorist flotilla heading toward Israel, right toward Hamas, they're invited. Israel, not invited. Another indicator. And by the way, Dianne Feinstein says this, right? Other Democrats say this. The Obama administration has repeatedly been leaking key, vital national security information about Israel to the world via the New York Times and the Washington Post. They've done it no less than three times. They've done it in order to try and stop Israel from attacking Iran. The first time, they leaked information from the Defense Department that Israel was going to use Saudi airspace in order to hit Hadi into Moron. The other one that they like to push is the Lilly Ledbetter Act, right? This one they push a lot. And this is big in California, the wage gap, right? The so-called wage gap between men and women. The easy answer to this one is, there's a factual answer again, and then there's the politic answer. The factual answer is that there is no wage gap in this country. For people who work the same amount of time, have the same amount of years at the job, and work the same number of hours, there is not only not a wage gap, there's a slight wage advantage for women. There are more women who are now going to medical school than men. There are more women in law school than men. The idea that women are somehow radically disadvantaged in American society is sheer crap. It is, and I, honestly, my wife is at UCLA Medical School, my mom is a working woman, she runs a studio. This is working, I'm all for working women. But let me just say this, if we could actually pay women 77 cents on the dollar to work, and we'd have to pay men 100 cents on the dollar to work, I guarantee you no men would be employed. Okay, now that's the non-politic answer. Okay, the politic answer is that the Lilly Ledbetter Act is not the way to solve the wage and gender imbalance. Because what the Lilly Ledbetter Act does is it extends the period for which people can sue. The only people who work under, the only thing that happens under the Lilly Ledbetter Act, which was Obama's first act in office, because this whole, you know, war on women meme that he's been pushing this for years. And it's a bunch of nonsense, and he's been pushing it because he knows that it works. The Lilly Ledbetter Act makes trial lawyers rich, doesn't help anybody else. Because what it does, it puts the burden on businesses. If you show up and you just show that you made less money than a man, now the burden shifts to the business to somehow explain why they're not sexist, which is fundamentally un-American. Burden of proof should be on the person who's making the charge. Right? So that's the real problem with the Lilly Ledbetter Act, leaving aside the basis of it, which again, is specious. Okay, how about energy? President Obama likes to say that he's increased drilling in the country. He has not increased drilling in the country. Drilling has increased on private land. It has decreased on public land. The actual statistic, and there's a reason, by the way, that gasoline prices this week were up to $3.72 on average. That's a 26-cent leap in the last month, and it's up over $2 from when President Bush was president. You know, the horrible, evil, terrible President Bush. Oil production overall is higher than it has been in 8 years. That's because 96% of the increase came from land not owned by the federal government. In 2011, oil production on federal lands declined by an average of 275,000 barrels per day. It increased on private land more than that by about 400,000 barrels a day. So private land is where it's at, public land is where it's not at, and there's a reason for that, which is that President Obama has a goal, and he expressed it very clearly before the election. He wants to raise oil prices so that we can reduce pollution and we use less oil. He wants to make us energy independent. He'll have to bankrupt the country to do it, but at least, you know, you'll be driving a lighter car or you'll have a Segway. So that's the upside. The downside is that, you know, the few of us who are still making money will have to pay for those Segways. Okay, so how about taxes? President Obama has claimed that he has not raised taxes. This is true. He has not raised taxes. It's not for lack of trying. President Obama will, if you count Obamacare as a tax, it's the single biggest tax increase in American history. I don't count Obamacare as a tax because it's a mandate, no matter what John Roberts and his foolish compatriots on the Supreme Court say. It's not a tax, it's a mandate. But if we're going to claim that it's a tax, it is the single largest tax increase in the history of the United States. We can talk a little bit more about Obamacare in just a second. The fact is that President Obama has said that he wants the Bush tax cuts to expire not for reason of economic health, but for reasons of fairness. He said this in the debate back in 2008. He said, he was asked specifically, if you know that tax increases are going to hurt the economy, are you still for them? And he said, yes, for purposes of fairness. Direct quote. That's all he cares about. All he cares about is fairness. He doesn't care about the growth of the United States economy, and he certainly doesn't care about lowering anybody's taxes. So this poses a middle class, you know, lower class warrior. When he says he's cutting taxes for, you know, people who are low income, no, he's not, because they don't pay taxes. He's giving them money from your pocket and calling it a tax rebate. You know, by that standard, every time I get a check from my company, I'm getting a tax rebate. Because, you know, hell, money that comes from anywhere is a tax rebate now, apparently. It's insipid, it doesn't make any sense. President Obama is going to raise taxes come 2013. And this just came out from the CBO today. If he does raise those taxes, the unemployment rate is going to rise to 9% immediately. And by the way, it'll rise to higher than that, because it turns out the CBO, this is the problem with the CBO, and you should, good informational point, a point of order, you know, for you when you check out the CBO. The CBO only calculates data that they're given. It's garbage in, garbage out. If they're giving bad data, this has happened with what happened with Obamacare. If they're given bad data by the administration, that's what they calculate. The data that they were given by the administration, calculating what would happen if the taxes would rise, assumed, get this, that there would be a surge in tax revenue in 2013. To 18.4% from 15.7% of GDP. So there'd be almost a 3% increase in tax revenue, even though the economy would tank. So unemployment would go up to 9%, but somehow we'd make more money in taxes. No. Not gonna happen. That's not what happens when you raise taxes. There may be a short-term revenue increase, and then it immediately sinks. So the economy will be even worse than that because the government won't be able to pay for any of this, which of course increases the debt. Which brings us to the debt. When people say that there was this meme going around a few months ago, now liberals don't like to argue, and this is the substantive stuff that liberals don't like to argue. So this is why I say, don't bother arguing with liberals. You can tell a liberal within the first 5 minutes of conversation if they don't want to stick on one topic. This is the hallmark. If they start sliding around, right, you start talking about the budget, and all of a sudden you find yourself talking about gay marriage. You realize, oh, wait a second, something happened here. Honestly, if you are talking about tax increases, and all of a sudden they're talking about the Lilly Ledbetter Act and why Romney hates women because he's a Mormon, put a dog on top of his car, you're in the wrong conversation. Get out immediately. Don't leave. You know, if there's somebody else there, leave him behind. Run, man. There's no time. Get out. So here's the story on the deficit. There was a meme going around about. You know, the second thing is that when you're speaking to somebody who is convincible, there are certain linguistic things you probably should not do. Don't talk about how Obama's not born in the United States. It's not true, and it's a waste of time. Don't talk about how he's a socialist. It is true, but it's a waste of time. Don't talk about how he has, you know, un-American views on foreign policy, which, again, is true, but is a waste of time. When I say un-American, what I say is not traditionally American. He doesn't believe in a muscular American foreign policy. The key here when you're talking to, you know, your liberal friends is to kind of use Alinsky tactics. I'm a big fan of Saul Alinsky. If you haven't read Rules for Radicals, you absolutely should. It's a brilliant book. Saul Alinsky was a brilliant man. Despite the demonization of Saul Alinsky, his book is well worth reading. What he says in his book, essentially, is that the way to convince people is to freeze a target, pick a target, freeze it, and then polarize it. That's true of issues, too. When you sit down with your liberal friends, first thing you should do is you should ask them why they're voting for Obama, or how they're voting, and then why they're voting that way. Don't lead off the conversation with, here's why you shouldn't vote for Obama, because it will immediately alienate them. Then when they start throwing issues at you, you can knock them down one by one. The good news is that President Obama is the worst president in the history of the United States, with the exception of James Buchanan. So it gives you a lot of material to work with. That's the good news. The bad news is that a lot of people have been dramatically misinformed by the media about the nature of President Obama's record on everything from economics to foreign policy to social policy. So the way that I sort of decided to structure this tonight was I wanted to go down kind of some of the key points, I think, that come up that in discussions that I've had with some of my liberal friends, and shamefully, I do have liberal friends. One of them, you're here with me on the Heidi Harris Show. Brian Littman's a liberal, and Brian's a sweetheart, but he's wrong. So I have a list of issues, and I think they're worth discussing and how to tackle each one of them. The first one that you get a lot from folks, especially liberals, is Obama made the decision to kill Osama bin Laden. Now, there are two ways to handle this question. There's the right way and there's the wrong way. Yeah. The right way is factually correct, but tactically incorrect. The factually correct answer is that President Obama did make a good call after waffling around for 3 days and after voting against everything that would have allowed us to gain the intelligence that led to the kill of bin Laden. That's factually correct. And when he issued the memo that called for the kill of bin Laden, which is written by Leon Panetta, it was basically a throw somebody under the bus memo. It was, if something goes wrong, we're going to blame this on Admiral McMullen. That's essentially what the memo says. I mean, I have the text of it right here. Essentially, it says, the approval is provided on the risk profile presented to the president. Any additional risks are to be brought back to the president for his consideration. The direction is to go in and get bin Laden. Now, there are a couple problems with that. This is just, you know, kind of for background information. First problem with that is that it's a fluid situation. If you went back to President Obama every time there was a differentiation in the risk profile, the mission never gets done. So if any additional risk happens, if the helicopter goes down, for example, as it does, and they call up Obama, they say, should we proceed? You know, he has the option to say no. If they go ahead and they kill bin Laden, great, he gets the credit. If not, if you know the phone suddenly cuts out, and then he can always find somebody to blame. The other problem with that is that he says to go in and get bin Laden. This is the language that led to the unclarity in the aftermath of the bin Laden kill. You heard a lot of people saying, well, was it a kill order or was it a capture order? The answer is it was neither. It was a get bin Laden order. And so that gave him the freedom to kind of claim one way or another. The White House couldn't even decide on its messaging. That's the factual answer. It's also the wrong answer to give to liberals. The reason is because everybody in the United States is firmly convinced that Obama made the heroic call to kill bin Laden and did it with ease and with confidence.
Absolutely.
That being the case, the proper answer to the he killed bin Laden is, you're right, he did, now let's look at the rest of his record. Because guess what? You kill one dude, it doesn't really change the world all that much, even bin Laden. And it was a wonderful thing when bin Laden ended up, you know, smoldering with gun holes in him. That was wonderful. When he was bleeding out, you know, the world was celebrating, it was great. But guess what? Al-Qaeda still existed. We are still cutting and running in Afghanistan because we do not have a comprehensive plan there. We already cut and run in Iraq and it's being turned over to Iran. The entire Middle East is being converted to an Islamist awakening. The Europeans are taking precedence over us in terms of largely negotiations with Syria. We've thrown our allies under the bus, Israel in particular, and I'll get to more on that later. So the issue is, we have to keep the focus. This is the real issue of this campaign, and you've seen it with Paul Ryan, to digress for just a second. You've seen it with Paul Ryan. Ryan focused the campaign. For about 10 days there, we were actually talking about stuff that mattered. We were talking about Medicare. We were talking about the economy. We were talking about the nature of what the next 50 years in this country is going to look like. And then Todd Akin said something about magic uteruses, and we were back to talking about nonsense. And we've been talking about nonsense for the last 48, 72 hours because he said that women's uteruses have magical capacity to determine the difference between rape and consensual sex. This is not exactly what we should be talking about at this point in time. So when people say things, you know, they'll do the same thing about Todd Akin, which I'll get to a little bit later too. When they say this, you say, you know what, you're right. Now let's get back to the issues that matter. Because guess what? Todd Akin's a dude from Missouri, and our country is still going to pay the entire military budget of the country of China just with the interest on our debt by 2020.
Wow.
Okay. So that's the answer on Bin Laden. Second one is, hasn't Obama created jobs? This one should be a no-brainer, but it's good for you to have the data at your fingertips. The annual growth rate under President Obama has been 2% since the recovery began. That is the weakest single recovery in the history of the United States since World War II. He has created less jobs than any president of the United States since World War II, according to the Washington Post. Okay, the Obama Washington Post. President Obama has done a horrible job on the economy. We'll talk about his tax policy and his spending policy in just a moment. But the fact of the matter is that when they talk about number of months that he's had, you know, consistent job creation, it's easy enough to do that when you inflate the currency and spend enormous sums of cash. You can do that. You just can't do it indefinitely, and the recovery will not end up being President Obama the deficit, that he is actually a fiscal conservative. I don't know if you saw this. Right? And the fact that it gets such a big laugh when I just say that means that you're not going to get liberals arguing that too much. But there was this meme going around for a while that President Obama, and it was a manipulation of the math, that President Obama had actually not increased government spending that much. That's true to a certain extent. It's true if you consider the last Bush year, the last Bush budget that was submitted, and then was greenlit by Obama's Democratic Congress. If you consider that the baseline, then yeah, Obama hasn't increased spending that much. But that's like saying you smash up your car in a wreck, it sets on fire, and you buy yourself a new car. And then every year, till the end of time, you buy a new car, you haven't increased your spending that much, because that first year, you bought a car. Okay, when the economy went bad and you spent a lot of money, that doesn't mean you get to spend that much money every single year. You're supposed to bring it back down, right? During World War II, after World War II happened, guess what? We decreased spending. You know why? Because we weren't in a war, right? I mean, this is what happens. Spending goes up, spending goes down, unless you're President Obama, in which case the ratchet only works one way. So here's Obama's spending record, okay? Stimulus package, $1 trillion. Supplemental spending bill, $410 billion. Ship expansion, $40 billion. Obamacare, $1.6 trillion over the next 10 years. It will be more than that. He's now spending a full quarter of America's GDP versus an average of 19.6% under President Bush. That's an increase of almost 6% of the American GDP being spent by the government. The last year, in 2008, our annual budget was about a little under $3 trillion. It's going to be, this year, about $3.8 trillion. President Obama is so extreme, when he calls Paul Ryan an extremist, it's actually laughable. Paul Ryan got a majority of the House to vote for him and 40 votes in the Senate. President Obama got this many votes in the House and the Senate for his last two budgets. This many. Zero. Not a single Democrat voted for it because they knew how asinine it was. And they knew that they would have to go back to their constituents and explain why their constituents were paying for toilet paper for unemployed minors in Pennsylvania. There's four straight years of budget deficits came out today at over $1 trillion. So that's a non-starter. As far as benefits, President Obama's entire plan, and this goes to the key of who President Obama is. Again, not something for arguing, but a good informational point. Want to know where Obama's going? The answer is, he's creating a society in which more of us are dependent on government than are not dependent on government, so Democrats will win every election until the end of time. There are 100 million people who are currently dependent on federal benefits. 100 million people. And in terms of state benefits, probably higher than that. We've got, I think there are 43 million people on food stamps.
Yes.
Under President Obama?
49.
40, is it 49 now? Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it'll keep increasing. The fact is that President Obama wants nothing more than to put people on these benefits in the name of kindness and humanity. Now, there's two ways to read that from President Obama. One is that he's a kind and generous human being with your money. And two is that this is part of a cohesive Democratic plan that has been taking root since the 1930s to make more and more people dependent on the federal government so that you will need to keep electing these politicians. The problem I have is that the Republican Party for too long went along with this nonsense. And there's a reason for that too, which is, guess what? How many of us would actually be giving lots of money to either party if the government were insignificant in our lives, as Rick Perry wanted to make it? We wouldn't. They'd be a bunch of schlubs who go up to Washington and don't bother us for a couple of years and, you know, aren't around to soil our doorsteps, and, you know, everything would be great. When people say that President Obama golfs too much, my answer is I wish he were golfing every day so he couldn't do anything. I'll let all these guys go out and play basketball. I want Obama, you know, throwing like a girl at the All-Star game every day of the week. Yeah, exactly. Good. Keep them there. So the fact is that if we want government to become, and this is where we really come in as the voters, if we want government to be insignificant in our lives, the only way that's going to happen is if we say that the politicians that we elect don't get to make a call. And this is one of the things that I like about Mitt Romney, to digress for one second. I was not a Mitt Romney proponent in the primaries. I was initially a Rick Perry proponent before we discovered that he has problems with the English language. Once we realized that, then Romney became the only viable choice, just because everybody else, it was like the Wheel of Fortune primary. Literally, Rick Santorum was the last man standing on the right side of the stage in the first primary. I said this, and we were going to go through every single person until we got to Rick Santorum, because people just, Romney was everybody's second or third choice, and we ended up with Mitt Romney. That's fine. It's totally fine. But, you know, he's not exactly an inspiring candidate, which is why we needed Paul Ryan. That being the case, there's one good thing about Mitt Romney. There's one really good thing about Mitt Romney. It's not that he's a deeply principled guy, because I don't think he is. It's not because he is a strong Reagan-esque conservative, because I'm not sure that he is. I don't know. I don't think anybody really knows. I think Romney maybe, I know Ryan is, but I have my questions about Romney. But here's the nice thing. Romney is susceptible to public pressure. I like that. It means that if we pressure him and we push him the right way, he will do what we want him to do. I don't like hero worship of presidents. There was too much of it with George W. Bush, and it allowed him to spend egregious amounts of money doing silly things. If we don't worship our politicians, we're better off. I think the last 4 years have proved that. So, you know, that's the good news about Mitt Romney. Okay, final point. Final point here about Obama. His big legislative accomplishment, thanks to John Roberts. I can't even discuss John Roberts. I'm a Harvard law grad, and John Roberts is a disgrace to my alma mater. He is. It was the worst decision. I thought it was the single worst legal decision, certainly since Roe. Maybe worse than Roe. It was an egregiously bad legal decision. But now that it's the law of the land, at least for the moment, until we win the presidency and the Senate, Obamacare. We've been told that Obamacare is the cure-all for everything. Your liberal friends will think that it is. When you ask them why we need Obamacare, they'll tell you that it's because there are 30 million uninsured people in this country, and they need insurance. There's only one problem. In 2012, the CBO estimated how many people would be uninsured, left uninsured, under Obamacare because they would lose, you know, their private insurance, because they'd lose their jobs, for whatever reason. The answer? The Iranian nuclear facilities. That came out, Saudis immediately pulled that off the table. The second time, they leaked that Israel had been involved in the Stuxnet virus, right? That was the really, really cool virus they used to shut down the Iranian nuclear facilities for a while. It's a super cool thing. And they leaked that it was Israel that had done that, right? Undercutting Israeli security. The third way, recently, they did this, the worst of all, was that Israel had a deal with Azerbaijan to use its air bases in order as a staging point for an attack against Iran. The Obama administration leaked that to the press, killing the deal. The Obama administration is still, just the other day, on the press plane, the Obama press secretary, Jay Carney, who's a Rachel Maddow lookalike in his day job, Jay Carney. Jay Carney was aboard Air Force One.
Poor Jay.
Yeah, really. Poor Rachel. Jay was aboard Air Force One. He was giving his press gaggle to the sycophantic press, and they asked him about Iran. And he said, we still think there are many diplomatic options available, despite the fact that nothing has happened. In fact, he said, we're pushing Israel to exercise those diplomatic options. This is who President Obama is. This is also the president, of course, who has facilitated the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt, who is facilitating the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood in Libya, who has facilitated the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood in Tunisia. His foreign policy record isn't just bad, it's abysmal. What he's done with Russia has been abysmal. The bear is on the move again. Vladimir Putin is emboldened, and he's making territorial moves in Ukraine. If you look at China, China has been massively emboldened. They are actually making military moves in the South China Sea against the Philippines, if you've been following that. This is what Joe Biden predicted back in 2008 when he was running against President Obama for the nomination. He said, when you have a president who's brand new and has no experience and who looks kind of weak, people are going to start pushing the envelope. That's what's happened. Obama has not pushed back. America is not safer for it. America is less safe in the world. There's virtually no argument on that. Okay, next issue, same-sex marriage. This one, obviously, this is Obama's key. It's amazing to me that this is true, but this has become the centerpiece of his campaign. It's not a real good strategy, considering the swing states in this country are Virginia, Ohio, Florida, Pennsylvania, and a vast panoply of Rust Belt states that don't like same-sex marriage. I mean, the fact is that he's going to get a lot of negative heat when he's in North Carolina because of the same-sex marriage position. Now, we're in California. Same-sex marriage, obviously, a very popular proposition. A lot of us work in Hollywood. And that is, for my money, and when I wrote my book, I talked to a lot of the big executives, at the studios. And essentially, it is almost the work-don't-work line. If you voted for Prop 8 or contributed money to the Prop 8 effort, there's a solid, and they find out about it, there's a solid chance you'll be discriminated against, or that you won't work altogether. So, that being the case, let's not take this one from the position of traditional marriage is superior to same-sex marriage, even though I personally believe that because I'm a religious person, and also I think there are solid secular reasons to believe that. It's not a winning argument in the state of California in particular. So the real answer is, okay, President Obama's for same-sex marriage, what has changed? And the answer is, nothing has changed. Precisely the same number of people who could get married before can still get married, and precisely the same number of people who can't. And President Obama has done nothing to change that. It's an attitude, I mean, it sounds great, but it's been largely irrelevant. And in the end, it will probably end up being a states' rights issue. This is going to go to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court will probably declare that it's a states' rights issue. They're not going to declare, I can't say, well, actually, you know what, I should revise that. It may be a moot point pretty soon, because Anthony Kennedy is the swing vote on the Supreme Court. He voted in favor of Lawrence v. Texas, right, which said that sodomy was a right in the Constitution. So Anthony Kennedy's a kook, and he could vote that the founders in 1791, when they ratified the Constitution of the United States, actually wanted two men to get married. But, it could remove the topic from the table. But leaving that aside, the policy is not actually going to change. And the difference between Romney on this policy and Obama on this policy makes no practical difference. And again, not the central issue. And that's the point that's worth emphasizing again. This is not the central issue of this election. It really is not. We could have nominated Rick Santorum, and then it would have been the central issue of this election. We nominated Mitt Romney specifically so that this would not be the central issue of this election. Okay, which brings us to the vastly talked about this week, abortion issue, right? This is something that the left loves to talk about because it's just, it's a key issue for them, and it's the only way they can keep people in the fold is by scaring the hell out of single women in particular. Married women tend to poll extremely high in favor of pro-life decisions. Single women tend to poll very high in favor of pro-choice decisions. The left has therefore tried to polarize this debate and essentially say that the Republican Party wants you to use coat hangers. Now, I'm not just saying that. That was the headline on Huffington Post yesterday. I don't know if you saw this. There was actually a large graphic of a coat hanger. Joan Crawford would have been thrilled. It was...
Hollywood show.
Oh, mommy dearest. Anyway. Okay. Here's the story on abortion. Once again, when it comes to abortion, this is not an issue that's going to play a large role in this campaign or in American policy going forward. Even if Roe v. Wade were overturned, there will be no difference for people who live in California, right? And presumably you're speaking mostly to your friends who live in California. If your friends are living in Alabama and they're really that concerned about abortion, tell them to move. It's called federalism. There's a reason for it, right? If people want to abort their children, abort their fetuses, whatever you want to call it, their embryos, they can do that in California, they can do that in New York, they'll be able to do it in Massachusetts, they may not be able to do that in Texas, but guess what? We can agree to disagree. That's why we have a federalist society. And you can tell them this, too. The Republicans are never going to get enough of a majority to pass a pro-life amendment. It's just not going to happen. It never will happen. There will never be a pro-life constitutional amendment in this country. So that should obviate the abortion issue. When they mentioned Todd Aiken, there's a reason that Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan both called Todd Aiken and told him to get out. And he should have gotten out. And the fact that he didn't, it's a disgrace, and he's an egotist of beyond measure, because Obamacare could end up becoming law. We'll talk about Obamacare in just a second. Obamacare could end up being enshrined in law because...